sure you are. Welcome to worship here at Incarnation. We're so glad you're here with us. If you're a first-time guest, this is what it's like every Sunday. I'm just kidding. But we're glad that you're here if you are a first-time guest. If you have any questions about some of the ministries going on after the service, feel free to talk to myself or Pastor Janet or any of the other smiling faces around. I'd be happy to meet you and talk to you about that. We have a lot of exciting things happening in worship today and in the building today. We'll get through some of those later on in the service. But first, I'd like for you to welcome the Jack Brass Band that's here leading worship. We're so glad you guys are here today. Knowing that we're leading up into Ash Wednesday, it's good to have something really celebratory, some great music to help lift our spirits as we enter and prepare ourselves to enter into the season of Lent. As we prepare for worship, I want to invite you all to please stand in body or in spirit and join me in our opening liturgy. From John's Gospel, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. In him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overtake it. In Jesus' words, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows Jesus will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. The Apostle Paul invites us to walk as children of the light, for the fruit of the light is found in all that is good and right and true. Try to find out what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in unfruitful works. Rather, expose them. Use this time of confession and reflection to bring the unfruitful words and deeds of your life into the light of Jesus' forgiving love." May the light of Jesus' forgiving love release you from regret and guilt, renew you with peace for the day, and re-energize you for all that is good and right and true. Let us walk as children of the light. We sing together. Thank you.
You may be seated. At this time, I'd like to just invite our children who are getting ready to go off into their Sunday school classes to, if you have one by you right now, maybe you could place your hand on them as we pray them out the door to their classes. Let's pray. Good and gracious God, you are the light of the world. You have come into the world to bring light and life and love and all that is good and right and true. We give you thanks today for our children. May they learn how you have gifted them and blessed them to be a blessing in the world. May their light shine. May their voices sing. May they be able to participate in a life of celebration. And in this one day today, may their joy, their day be filled with joy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may send ILC kids off. Well, today is a good day. We've got the Jack Brass Band. We've got waffles down the hall. We got an organ concert happening later on today. Amy Mockestead. A lot going on here. You could just pack a lunch and stay at church all day. Go home for the football game later on. But I feel like with all the celebration, I should be dressed for Mardi Gras. You know, I went to Mardi Gras in 1984. Down in New Orleans, Kirk Douglas was the grand poopah. And he was young back then. but yeah, I feel like I should be dressed in a jester costume or juggling something. You know, I can juggle basketball, so, you know, I might have to bring that out sometime. But it is a big day. And for those of you who like sports, it's a big day. I can't wait. I can't wait to see Caitlin Clark from the University of Iowa playing this afternoon as she goes for that record. Oh, I know. I know you're thinking about football. Maybe they're thinking about the food that goes along with the football or the funny commercials. Yes, it's a thing. Last year, there were 115 million people who watched the game on television. But for the thousands who literally spent thousands to be in the Allegiant Stadium in Las Vegas, they will get the full experience. They'll get the Taylor version. And, you know, right after Gladys Knight is done singing the national anthem, they'll hear a roar that builds up as the United States Air Force Thunderbirds come into sight. The crowd of 65,000 people will look upward, craning their necks as the Thunderbirds conduct this year's ceremonial flyover. How many of you have ever seen a flyover of F-16s or Blue Angels or something along those lines? It is incredible. Even if you're braced for it, six of these $40 million planes traveling at 400 miles an hour with their precision pilots literally able to fly with their wings 18 inches apart to one another. They come and they go in a flash, generating anticipation, excitement. And as that line of smoke trails behind, one cannot avoid a lingering gaze, wishing it would just last a little longer. And it's so true for most of our lives where we kind of miss what's happening because we're trying to get a picture of it. And then the picture on our cell phone never quite lives up to the magnitude of the moment, does it? You know, today is a big day in the life of the church. That's right, folks. It's Transfiguration Sunday. That somewhat puzzling event that is situated always between Epiphany and the beginning of Lent, which starts on Wednesday. And as we move to the text, just a couple of quick notes. I know some of you have been around and heard how Jesus has been teaching and preaching with his disciples, but he's also predicted to them that he will be persecuted and tried and will go to his death. And they just don't quite believe that. Peter said, no way, I'm not going to let that happen. And Joel, you preached on this too, where Jesus said, no, get behind me, Satan, to Peter, because he knew that it was going to be true for him. One other note is that Peter, James, and John will be craning their necks in this transfiguration text to see Jesus up on the mountaintop with the two Old Testament heavyweights, Moses and Elijah. This is going to be a mountaintop experience for them, both literally and figuratively. But it'll be over as soon as it began, leaving the men in awe. Our Bible reading today, if you'd like to pull it up on your phone, comes from Mark 9, verses 2 to 10. There are also Bibles in your pews. Mark 9, 2 to 10. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, bright, such as no one on earth could brighten them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us set up three tents, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud came a voice. "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until after the Son of Man had been raised from the dead. So they kept the matter to themselves, questioning what this rising from the dead could mean. You find this transfiguration text in all of the synoptic gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And you may have heard the similarities as I was reading into that baptism story from Matthew's gospel, where Jesus is baptized by John. The Spirit descends like a dove, and a voice comes from the heaven. "This is my son." Some, depending on the translation, "my beloved," or "this is my son whom I love. With him I am well pleased," he says in the baptism story. The way the text is written, the baptism story is God speaking actually to Jesus. But in this transfiguration story, God's voice comes from the cloud. This is my son whom I love. Listen to him. God is speaking to the disciples. The difference between the two is that added directive at the end, listen to him. Do we believe Jesus is God's son? Do we believe God loves him? Do we listen to Jesus? The transfiguration story is really like God skywriting a message to us, more dramatic than the smoking trails of the Air Force's Thunderbirds flying machines. God's voice pierces through that cloud for anyone who has ears to hear. Jesus' appearance was changed. That's where the word transfiguration comes from. That change in form or appearance into a more beautiful or more spiritual state. But in this, and there's debates about what does this transfiguration story really mean. One of the clear messages we get is that we see Jesus' true identity, who he is, his divine nature, his glory, his power. Jesus is God's son revealed. He's exalted above Moses, above Elijah. He is a Messiah with the authority in this world and beyond. Now, throughout Mark's gospel, I think sometimes we wonder, why don't the disciples grasp what is going on about who Jesus is and what he came to do? But as readers of scriptures, we know that we've read the book, we know how it ends, we know the full story. Verse 9, when they were coming down the mountain, Jesus ordered them not to tell anyone until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. So they kept the matter to themselves, questioning what this rising from the dead could even mean. In a moment, it was confusing. We can look at Jesus' glowing experience as a preview of a future resurrection and transformed state, but it wouldn't make sense to disciples until later. Jesus told them to stay quiet because he knew they could not really be his witnesses until they had experienced how he would overcome death and rise again. How well do we really know Jesus. If someone asked you to take out a piece of paper and write down everything you knew about Jesus, could you fill a page? Could you fill two? Could you write a page about your favorite podcast? How about a page or two about our favorite Minnesota twin, Joe Mauer, who's going to Cooperstown this summer? Could you write a couple pages about him? Some of us could write a page about who our favorite Kardashian sister is, our favorite Disney princess, our favorite cruise line. We have a lot of things, a lot of rabbit holes that we go down in this world. And Joel and I can tell you all about going down rabbit holes for Jesus, right? As we sit on the verge of what will be our 40-day Lent journey, I invite you to consider your relationship with Jesus. How are you doing? Do you consider Jesus a friend? Is he an acquaintance? Is he a close personal friend? Is he your best friend? How are you doing? Is, as Kai says, it learning to live and love like Jesus for a lifetime? When St. John University, up in Collegeville, Minnesota, contacted a famous person named Donald Jackson to head the St. John's Bible Project in 1995, the calligrapher from England accepted because he had always wanted to write the Bible. Jackson was a well-known calligrapher. In fact, at one point, he was actually Queen Elizabeth's scribe. Now, Jan and Carl Kermeyer actually met the man who developed the whole St. John's Bible. And Carl Kermeyer said, at the time, he was the only Protestant on the St. John's College University board. He was the token Protestant, he would say with a smile. Carl and Jan got to meet Donald Jackson, and it gave them such great joy and pleasure when we actually got a heritage edition here at our church. And we have the edition of this image out in the atrium right now, and it will be out there if you'd like to be able to take a look at it more closely. We are blessed with these at this edition. We're also blessed with wonderful volunteers who want to help us learn more about Scripture by engaging in this work of art. Jackson's illumination from the St. John's Bible, this one called The Transfiguration, sparks the imagination. But one of the things you might notice right away, for those of you who have seen the icons of the Transfiguration in the Orthodox community, they usually have the three figures up there, but then they also have the three people down below, Peter, James, and John, down below in the picture also. And when you see them, they look afraid. They're cowering. They're covering their eyes. Their robes are all bunched up, and they're just laying there, not sure what to do. But they're not in Donald Jackson's version, because they are standing, watching, and looking at this transfiguration right alongside of us. When Donald began painting this piece, he laid down the gold first. Illumination, the word is defined as a play of light on gold. He painted on the top big, bold, blue strokes, saying where God said, "This is my son." And then he used a tool down at the bottom to paint jagged edges and the sharp rocks in that purplish color. You can see, "This is my son, the beloved." And down in the lower right-hand corner, "Listen to him." On the right, Moses is holding the two tablets, the Ten Commandments. On the left, the prophet Elijah is shown in more ragged clothing. And these men are in conversation with Jesus. Their faces were not painted by Donald Jackson. They were painted by an iconographer named Aidan Hart in the Orthodox icon form. Their posture and hands animated. And when you look at Jesus, you realize, hey, he doesn't have hands and feet like the others. Jesus is the center of this image, looking almost as though he's hovering above the mountain, shrouded in a garment of gold with white crosses on them. Gold, a prominent color in all of the St. John's Bible illuminations, the 160 of them, because it symbolizes divinity. This piece has a gold underlayer, but it's also got some gold leaf laid on top. Gold catches the light and shows movement. Jackson gave great thought to what should I do with Jesus' face. He wanted it to be different than the other representations he had in his work. Jesus' face is shown with much less detail, yet it's probably the most attention-grabbing item in the piece. He had started making this when he had some white paint. He used his fingernails to carve in and shape facial features of Jesus. He wanted Jesus' face to be different, to be one in which the viewer could see themselves. One writer said of Jesus' face, both present and absent, dazzling but piercing us with his gaze. What do you make of this vision of God's Son? Is this the Son of Man from Daniel? Is it difficult for us to process as it would be Jesus fully revealed? The image of Christ not only foretells his resurrection, but it also foretells ours. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 13, "For now we see a reflection in a mirror, but then we will see face to face. Now I only know in part, but then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known." Jesus said, "I am the light of the world." From John's Gospel, the light shines in the darkness. The darkness does not overcome it. New Testament professor Matt Skinner from Luther Seminary writes about the importance of having this transfiguration kind of in our back pocket as we face Lent, which begins on Wednesday, where you will gather here with us at noon or at 7 and hear the words as we mark you with a cross. "You are dust, and to dust you shall return." Matt Skinner says, "The bright light of the transfiguration affirms life, a light that shines ahead into Lent to keep that season in perspective, never without hope or confidence. This light speaks a promise that God is here and God is knowable. God seeks relationship because God is life." In a world of global suffering, we have our own lives of peaks and valleys, don't we? I mean, I hate to say it, but somebody's team is going to lose today. But I am so grateful for this faith community. I'm so grateful because I think, where else in the world can we gather as a community to be witnesses to the light? On the eve of this Lenten journey, the Transfiguration shows us how God, who has actually created light, has given us light in the person of Jesus. And this light draws us together as believers who come down from the mountain to walk with Jesus through the valley of the shadow of death.
transition into prayer after that. Let's pray together. Holy and loving God, as you instructed Jesus' disciples on that mountain, you invite us to live by that same call, saying to them, "This is my Son, the Beloved. Listen to him." God, we gotta be honest, sometimes it's easier some days than others to listen to that call, to live into it. And so we ask for forgiveness when we ignore Jesus' words. We ask that you would give us courage to face opposition when Jesus calls us to do difficult things. We pray for wisdom when we don't know what the right next step is for us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus, we lift up to you today those who are alone, for widows and widowers and orphans, for those who are going through marital disputes, for those who are struggling to find and make friends. Lord, come and be near them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the imprisoned, for those whose only home is the streets, and for those who are caught in addiction. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the hungry, for those who cannot feed their own children, for the unemployed and the underemployed. We pray for the upcoming legislation regarding the Farm Bill and the opportunity we have today to join our voices with others to encourage our representatives to take action to alleviate hunger in our country, in our state, and in our local community. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray especially for refugees, for victims of warfare. God, we sung this morning that we would lay down our swords and our shields by the riverside, that we wouldn't learn war anymore. And God, we sing that with conviction in our hearts. Jesus, we call you the Prince of Peace. And so we ask that you would help our world leaders to discover a new path forward that would end wars in Ukraine and in the Middle East. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Holy Spirit, as we've just sung, we feel as if we're almost on this precipice between life and death as we think about the transfiguration and the joy of what that means for us, knowing that one day we will be with you in heaven, and yet today we carry so many burdens into this space. We opened our worship singing about laying those burdens down, and we know yet that still tomorrow will come, that those burdens will be lifted up again on the shoulders of us. And so we pray for those feeling anxious today about an upcoming test at school or the fear of being bullied. We pray for those who are awaiting the dread of a medical diagnosis or are in desperate need of physical, emotional, spiritual, or mental healing. Allow us to trust you with whatever burden that might be as you hold us in your loving, compassionate, caring heart. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For all that we ask and all that you know we need, we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. One of the beautiful things about this service is not only do we get to sing and dance in the aisles and clap on the 1 and 3 and the 2 and 4 at the same time, but we also get to have joy and laughter because friends, we get to eat together. Not just waffles after the service, but we get to feast at the Lord's table. And that's who we turn our attention to at this moment. On the night in which our Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. As often as you eat of it, do so remembering me." In the same manner, after they had eaten supper, Jesus took the cup and he blessed it, saying, "This cup is the new covenant shed in my blood for the forgiveness of sins for all people. As often as you drink of it, do so remembering me." The bread which we break and the cup which we bless are the communion of the body and blood of Jesus Christ, who teaches us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. Here at Incarnation, Incarnation, we believe that Christ is the host of this meal, and so we invite all to come and to participate. So come if you haven't been for a while. Come if you're here every week. Know that you are welcome to this table. As you come forward, you receive the host a wafer, and we invite you then to take that wafer and to dip it into the cup. The cup has two liquids in it, a dark-colored liquid, which is wine, a light-colored liquid, which is white grape juice. You can then take those together. If you have need for gluten-free wafer, we have those available as well. Just ask your server. They'd be happy to give one to you. Today, if you're feeling more comfortable receiving communion through the pre-packaged cups, we have those available for you as well in each of the aisles. And we also know that we worship a God who is so generous in everything that God gives to us. And in response to that generosity, we have offering plates available for any tithes or offerings that you have brought today. If you'd rather give online, there's a number that you can text on the screen behind me to give in that way as well. But know that all are welcome to come and to participate in this holy meal. I'd like to invite the ushers and the communion service to come forward at this time. Thank you. Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in God's grace. Amen. A lot of next steps for us today. There's a lot happening to draw your attention to. If you came in this morning and grabbed one of these handouts, a lot of good details are included in that, so please pay attention to them. One of them, maybe as you came in this morning, you're already smelling the sausage and the waffles that were being made. And so immediately after this service, there's going to be waffles and breakfast going on. It's a fundraiser for our high schoolers going on the ELCA youth gathering this summer. If you didn't buy a ticket ahead of time, that's okay. You can buy one at the door. It's $10 a piece. It goes until noon. And so if you're worshiping online, you can come in and buy a ticket. Or if you're going to be attending our Cairo session, know that there will still be food after that as well. So we don't want to, we wanted to make sure there was time for those going to Kairos to be able to participate in that too. Additionally, I know it feels a little awkward that we're going to be gorging ourselves today on waffles, but there's also a really important farm bill that's coming up in legislation. And so today we have a chance just outside at those tables. You'll see people with some Valentine's things. Don't be distracted by the Valentine's. It's actually a chance to write letters to our legislators to help with those who are suffering from food insecurity. It's a really important ministry that we do here and a chance to have a great impact on our country, on our state, and in our community. So please take advantage of that and talk to Bernita and Dale after the service. They can help you with that. Our annual meeting will be next week, Sunday, and we know that there's a lot to digest and to get through. And so this afternoon, there's going to be a pre-annual meeting that will be taking place. That will be happening in Fireside. That's at 2:30 today. So you can get a chance to look at everything that's coming. If you have questions about that, our council members, they usually have really big name tags on. So after the service, you can talk to them about any of those details coming up. And then as Janet already noted this afternoon, our very own Jamie Mockestead is going to be leading a concert on the organ, featuring 300 years worth of organ music. It's going to be beautiful. It's going to be fantastic. Afterwards, you can have a little appetizer before the big game. There's going to be some cheese and some sparkling wine following that concert. So please join us for that at 4 o'clock. Next Sunday, at both of our services, this is the last announcement, I promise, but T. Michael Rambo will be coming back. And so many of you maybe saw him in the Hallmark movie this past year where he played Santa Claus. So please come and join us for that service. He's going to be doing some storytelling and leading us in music in both of our services next week. So be sure to invite a friend to that. Like I said, that was my last announcement. I invite you now to please stand and let's sing together a closing song. Thank you. Jack, brass band, for leading us in worship again today. It's been great to have you here. Thank you all for joining us in worship this morning. Remember to come on Wednesday at noon or 7 for our Ash Wednesday service. Now go with this sending. Walk as children of the light, for the fruit of the light is found in all that is good and right and true. Thanks be to God. And next week, bring a friend.